Thank you everybody for joining us today. I'm Joel Silverman and welcome to the Montana Business Vlog. We're here today in Helena, Montana with our outstanding mayor. Most of you, I'm sure, have met or seen him on TV, heard him on radio. Mayor Wilmot Collins. Wilmot, thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Joel. Thanks for having me.
This is fantastic. I can't tell you how challenging this is for me, what a pleasure it is, because we aren't political based, but I said, this guy's got such a great, interesting story of challenges, of things that most of us in business would never even contemplate, but you've gotten through things that are just astounding to me. For our viewers, if you haven't seen his TEDx, please do yourself the favor, go do that. Do it right now. It's TEDx Helena. It's an easy Google search to pick it up. Even I was able to figure it out in about 30 seconds. Pretty simple. And I'll tell you what, this guy's voice in that TEDx, it's like putting a baby to sleep. He just soothes you through it. It is amazing. So I'm going to try and keep some energy up and not let him soothe me into that nice, soft sleep, because he's just Mr. Rico Suave here. So, you know, Mayor, I got to ask you right out the gate, how was it doing a TEDx? How was the prep for it?
You know, it was challenging in a sense that time factor, you had to. There's no way you can say, I'm not going to practice, I'll just wing it. Because when it was time. So I had to be able to say what I wanted to say within the allotted time. And that was challenging for me because sometimes I tend to just want to spill my guts. And time is not of the essence. But with the TEDx, you had to have your facts, you had to have your story, and you had to have the time. And putting those three together was pretty challenging. But I was able to accomplish it with practice.
Mm-hmm. So, many people in business, they hit hurdles all the time. When they get to those hurdles, they don't know where it's going to take them, right? They don't know what's on the other side of the hurdle. What made you say, I want to run for office?
You know, I've always said that. One of these days I will run for a political office. You know, I'm interested in the process. I want to be able to do this. And then, of course, with our former president always saying, don't boo, vote. Be a part of the process. I thought it was a unique way. And then with my son coming in and saying, Dad, this is your year. I think you can do it. With him outlining to me my qualification, because I challenged my son when he said, Dad, I think you should run. This is your year. Every year you're talking about wanting to run. This year you will win. And I challenged him and said, why do you think I'm qualified? And he outlined my qualifications and said, Dad, this is it, you can do it. With the former president saying, don't boo, don't vote, with my son challenging me to go forward, I had no alternative. I was going for it. And so,
well, that's fantastic. That's an ultimate burning the boat and taking the island, because you can't let your son down, can you?
No. I can't.
So, and it sounds like he made a heck of a compelling argument for you.
He did. Because, you know, and when you tell your kids you will do this, you may think they're not listening. They are listening. They will hold you accountable, especially if they come up right. They're going to hold you accountable. You said this, that, and it's been how many years now you haven't done it? And so when he said, this is your year, and he gave me reasons why it was my year, I said, okay, I'll do it under one condition. He said, what? I said, you tell your mom that this is what we're planning. He said, oh no, that's your wife. You tell her. Because that was the hardest hurdle there. Tell him, because she does not want to get involved in politics. She doesn't like the limelight. She wants to stay in the background. And doing this would have put her in the limelight. And so that was a hurdle we had to go across. But my son refused to tell her. I had to tell her.
So how'd that go?
She put her hand up, keep me out of it. But, you know, in my household, we tend to vote. I said, let's vote on it. Let's vote. And of course, my daughter agreed, my son agreed, and I agreed. So it was 3-1. She had to get on board.
Well, that's fantastic. Yeah. So you had gone through the amnesty program, right, to come to the United States from Liberia. Your wife was actually in college at Carroll College in Helena.
Yeah.
What were some of the difficulties, the self-doubting moments you had in coming to the U.S., getting through that lengthy process, and what were some of the things that just drove you constantly for that success?
You know, that's a very good question, and that question will help your audience hopefully understand that, because coming here as a refugee, that process is very intense, it's very detailed, and downright invasive. I remember going through minimum of 5 different interviews, and I was so, it was so invasive. I called my wife and said, I'm done. I'm not doing this anymore. They're tearing my life apart. And all she told me was, you have to. They know what they're doing. In God's time, you will join us. But you have to go through that process because you have a family here waiting for you. I mean, that assurance that they were still waiting for me was just too much to let them down. It was just ideal, I guess. And so I went through that. Those interviews with State Department, with USCIS, with DHI, Department of Homeland Security, FBI, and all those things. And believe me, they know you. You are not going to tell a lie that they will not. You know, they will ask questions and you think they're done, and then twist the questions another way. And I mean, it was just, you know, going through that process and then going through the medical and then going through, it built me. Actually, I always tell people, if I can go through the refugee process, I can go through anything. I went to boot camp. I went to boot camp at age 31. When people should be going there at age 17 and 18. I went there at age 31 and I topped my boot camp. That's the determination I got from what I went through. And that's why I always tell people, man, you gotta do a lot to really get me going. Because what I've been through with those things, fleeing that war, dropping from 172 pounds to 90 pounds, almost dying of starvation, going through that refugee process with the UN and the US government, and going through boot camp at 31. The kids call me grandpa. Come on. I'm ready. I'm ready for whatever you bring.
That is fantastic. In the first two little stories here now, a recurring theme, accountability. Right?
Yeah.
So many times in business, we feel like, well, how do I get accountability? Right away, you were hitting home on family.
Yeah.
You clearly lean very heavily on your family for accountability. Yeah. Your wife, your children. How did you come to that? Is that something that you just feel came naturally with your family? Or
you know, part of that, because we're a close-knit family, even back home in Liberia. You know, I grew up in a pretty well-to-do family. My mom was superintendent of schools. My dad was civil engineer. They worked for Firestone Plantation Company. A lot of people in this country are not aware that the Firestone tires, the B.F. Goodrich, Bridgestone, all that material comes from Liberia. We have the world's largest rubber plantation. And so when and my parents worked for that company, so we're a close native family. And when my wife said, your family's here waiting for you, I know what it is. It's not about me anymore. When I always tell people, when you have kids, you're done. It's about those kids. It's not about you. So when my wife said, we're waiting for you, So my heartache, my pain is nothing compared to what they're going through also. So I had to make it happen. I had to go through that.
That's fantastic. Some of my business mentors, if you will, folks that books that I read, doesn't matter if it's a Branson or a Tony Robbins, you name it, one of the biggest themes they have is about giving back, right? Yep. Giving back to society, giving back to your family, community. It's not just about you.
Yeah, it's not about you anymore because, like my wife and I, when we finally got into America, I said, how can we give back? In fact, I stumbled on getting involved in the military. I got involved in that too by chance because there was a lady who had invited me to subscribe to the Helena Independent Record. And I told her I read the paper at work and then she said, why don't you join the National Guard? I said, whoa, you just wanted me to subscribe to a paper. Now you want me to join the National Guard. What's going on? And she said, well, if you have your weekends to yourself, it's easy work, you know. And it's a pretty decent pay and this and that. And she gave me the name of a recruiter. And so I tried to test the system because I told her, I said, no, I'm a refugee. I'm not an American citizen. She said, as long as you're here legally, you can be in the military. So of course, I didn't think she knew what she was talking about because as a refugee, I didn't think you could join the military. And so I started the process and sure enough, I could. And before I knew it, I was swearing in. I went to Butte and swore in and a few weeks later, I was in South Carolina boot camp. So yeah, giving back is a huge part. And you know, and a lot of people don't understand that. Doing this work I'm doing now as the mayor, it's not financially satisfying. Some people will say, oh man, you're making so much money as a mayor, you're doing this. No. It's not about the money because I'm not getting paid for what I'm doing. So it's about giving back to this community that accepted me when I was at my lowest. This community said, hey, we'll pick you up. You go shine. And now that I'm shining, why not do something? Why not give back to the community to help me? That's what it's about. I give back to the military, the sacrifice. My wife also decided she wanted to join, but because the two of us, we refused to have the two of us in the same time for fear that the two of us might have been deployed or activated. So my wife just joined 6 years ago. And she was almost aging out before she joined because the kids had all grown up out of high school. So it was time just the two of us and she joined. And my daughter, and I try to instill that in my family and say, you know, service is it. Service is the biggest deal because from where we're from, had it not been for service, we wouldn't be here today. So.
You almost brought me to tears there.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So, service. Helena, being a government town, I hear sometimes people say, oh, Helena, it doesn't have a lot going on. There's not a lot happening there. But I always tell them, you haven't spent any time here then, because you don't know what's happening in Helena, if that's what you're saying. Touch for me a little bit on the service-oriented nature of the Helena community.
Look, I'll tell you this. In the last 3 weeks, I've been to more than 10, 15 events. And I've participated in quite a few of them. And for the amount of nonprofit in this community, it's alarming. It's alarming. Like, about 3 weeks ago, I participated in Exploration Works. It's the science camp for kids. And they had a fundraiser. And they wanted me to donate something. I said, well, I don't know what to donate. You pick something for me to donate. And it's okay, why don't you donate karaoke with the mayor. I said, oh, you're not going to get much money out of that. Karaoke with the mayor. But guess what? Karaoke with the mayor raised $9,200.
Wow.
$9,200. Dinner with the mayor raised $2,500. In that week, the Helena community, within 3 weeks span, I was a part of events that raised over $1 million.
Wow.
Just in this community, in the 3 week span, over $1 million, from the YWCA to Care College to exploration work, those three entities. Mm-hmm. So things are happening here. Mm-hmm. And it's just that you have to, like you say, you have to get out to know it. You have to get out of that comfort zone. We're mm-hmm. also comfortable with the way we do things. We're scared to take that risk outside. We need to start taking the risk and getting out of our comfort zone and watch what happens.
What do you do to get yourself out of the comfort zone?
Man, every day I'm out of my comfort zone right now. I can't even get back in if I tried. Because like yesterday, I had to attend the burial of 153 people that were not claimed by families or relatives. We're talking about people who have been there from the 30s up to 2017. Unclaimed bodies. We had a burial for them at the county burial plot. That was a sad event. That's not my comfort zone. And then right after that, I had to go to the Capitol to read a proclamation for adoption month. We were adopting about 10 kids out in the community. You know, so there's so much going on. I just keep busy. As the mayor, there's no rest for the weary. I'm not kidding you. And so it's just been going.
Yeah. Well, I'd like to give a quick shout out to Helena Food Share.
Yes.
My wife is a land protection specialist for Prickly Pear Land Trust. Mm-hmm. And every year they go and they help out in the stocking shelves for the Helena Food Share. And what a great event to have one nonprofit stepping up to help out another nonprofit.
Yeah.
I thought that was just absolutely fantastic. I know there are several, as you said, it's amazing how many different nonprofits there are in this community.
That are surviving.
And doing fantastic. Yes. And really taking some amazing steps to not just be about connecting with the Helena community, but the greater state and country as a whole. I know as part of my time that I volunteer with Montana Project Healing Waters, we have donors from around the country who help us out so that we can get veterans out on the water, teach them fly fishing, fly tying, and just giving them another avenue to really get outside and enjoy life. Yeah. So I feel that 100% what you've said about that is a community. Shifting gears on you a little bit.
Okay.
Being mayor, I've got to imagine, is like being the CEO of a company.
It's a big company, yeah.
Yeah. You've got a lot of employees riding on you. And I know you've got a master's degree in HR from Troy, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
How have you utilized those skills, those HR skills, to develop a culture here within the government in Helena?
Do you know... The average person who does not have the HR skill will not understand that there are processes in place that we have to follow as an entity. For example, people would talk about, doing the city commission vacancy. That's a process that must be followed. We owe it to the community. The first thing we do is get a date when our commissioner is resigning, and then we shoot out the ad, invite the public in. For this one, we got 11 applicants right now that we'll be interviewing, but it's a public process. Mm-hmm. You have to inform the public that, hey, It's not like the regular business where you send out your ad, they apply, you don't deal with the public if they don't, and you go in your corner and you do your... We are interviewing those applicants publicly in the chambers. People will be there. They will listen to us interview. So I understand that process. As a matter of fact, part of me prefers that process so they can see the sincerity, so they can see the transparency. Because when you do the regular business where you're in your office and you're interviewing, people tend to, you know, be more lackadaisical. They tend to favor. But if when we select someone, I am sure the public will say that person was the best candidate, because all eyes are on you. So I've come to realize that the public and private sector, being in the private sector, has helped me focus on the public sector. It's easier, I think, with the public sector, because the transparency, you have to be transparent.
So in some of the business books I've read about business culture and the interviews I've been doing through this business vlog, one of the things that really sticks out to me is that culture trumps skills all day long. How do you go about that in the government side of the world?
You see, and you're right, because, you know, coming into this, there's already a culture I have to get adopted to. Because I came from the... And I'm still in the private sector, as a matter of fact. But like my mom always said, you have two ears to listen and one mouth to talk. You listen more and talk less. It's an educational process, moving from one system to the other. And with the culture, you have to get involved in able to understand it. You cannot say, I will watch from the outs. You can't watch from the outs. You have to ask questions. You have to get involved. And then you'll be before you'll be comfortable being a part of that process or being a part of that culture. The culture is unique. Unique in the sense that whatever you do, if I get on my computer today and send an email to another commissioner, it's public. Mm-hmm. It goes straight to the newspaper and to the full public. You go on the website, it's there. Mayor and commissioners. So it's a getting used to process, because nobody's really leaving the private sector. Nobody's used to when you email someone going to the whole public, going to the newspaper. So everything you do, you have to be cautious. Everything you say, you have to be cautious. And that culture is... part of me like it, but then a part of me is saying, whoa, you know, it becomes a bit draining, because you get all these emails you have to read, you have to respond to, and people might not understand that you get 20, 30 emails a day that you have to respond to, and it may take a while for you to respond, and some people get antsy. I've written him, and he hasn't responded in 3 days. Jeez, you're there. I'm getting to you. But so, you know, that culture is totally different. It takes getting used to.
What has been your biggest challenge with culture coming in? Because I've got to imagine it's got to be very similar to someone getting hired in as a new CEO, getting elected in as a mayor. They have to be very, very similar in that all of a sudden you're coming into this big ship that has been running for hundreds of years without you. You come in, the new guy, and what are the big challenges culturally to make this what you have a vision for?
You see, when you run for public office, you have a platform. Mm-hmm. I had a platform. I ran on fully funding the providers of essential services, firefighters, EMTs, all of that, police. I ran on providing opportunities for affordable housing. I ran on curbing teenage and veterans homelessness. Now, when you get in, the first thing you do is you have to involve your new family, so to speak. Let them know, these are what I ran on, And this is what I'm, these are what I'm going to be focusing on. Because I told the community, this is what I'm going to do. And they put me here to do those things. And I know you have your own, we have our own citywide issues. But I'm also going to be focusing on these areas. And you have to sell it to them because they will be working along with you. And I met with the various organizations. And for the last 22 years, safety levy has failed in this community. But when I got in, I said, look, we have to meet the community where they're at. Let's go to them. Let's answer those questions. Let's, because everybody will have questions. Why should I raise my taxes for this purpose? They need an answer. And let's go answer those questions. For the first time in 22 years, it passed. We're almost 70%. That's telling. So within 5 months, that goal was accomplished after coming because it was sold to them. It was explained. The questions were answered. And they bought it.
How did you plan out or strategize that goal to achieve that?
I didn't do it alone. I did it with the stakeholders. There's no way I could have done it alone. I did it with the people involved in it. Firefighters. The community, co-workers, they had to buy it too. So the first set of people you sell it to are those stakeholders. And then after that, they help you in relaying the message.
Being at the top of a business can be a lonely place. I get this a lot from my clients when they're struggling psychologically, personally with the difficulties of what they have going. What is it like being a mayor?
You know, I always say it's no different from being anything else because my personality tells me that I must interact with people. From the guys that come in here, you can talk to them. There was, when they come in here to move the garbage, they are janitors. When they come in, they're not just coming in and leaving. We talk. How are things going? Your interaction with your stakeholders, your interaction with your employees, your interaction with your co-workers make a big difference in how they carry out their duties. It's that difference will tell the person, oh, this person cares about me. Let me care about myself and do what I'm supposed to do. This is not just a job that is thankless. No. Every single person in this building is important. Without one person, something's going wrong. With the janitors not cleaning the bathroom, we may have to leave the building and go somewhere else. With people not, with all of us not connecting and getting done what we should do, the city's in trouble. And so it has to start from me. I have to model that. I have to model. And so with that, they see it. It becomes easier. People get to do the job. I remember when I came on, my first day, I think I met with 14. I had 14 meetings back to back because I wanted to meet with people. I wanted to know where they stood. I wanted to introduce them to myself and say, this is who I am. Work with me. You know, and when you're used to one way, I know they were used to the former mayor. He had been here for 16 years. So they had their own routine. And there's someone new coming. But I'm not the one to tell you, say, hey, you're doing things wrong. I'm about to watch and include my ideas. No, you've been doing this for 16 years. You've been doing it this way, and it has worked. The only thing we can do about it is improve on it. And so I bring whatever I bring, let's use it. Let's see how we can improve on what we've been doing for 16 years. And it's working.
That's fantastic. There's a great story about Alcoa, one of the world's largest aluminum producers. They were going through some troubles, gone through several CEOs. I believe they went through four CEOs in 3 years at one point. And they bring in the new CEO, and he goes to give his presentation to the board and the institutional investors in the audience, and he says, "I'm here for one thing and one thing only, the safety of the employees of this company." And one of the big institutional investors runs out the back of the auditorium, calls his trading desk and says, "Sell every share we have in Alcoa." He says it's one of the worst decisions he'd ever made as a trader, was to sell, because what he failed to understand was that that culture, that employees matter, that your team matters,
yes,
their safety matters. They will give back if you give to them.
Yes.
If you show that they matter, that you care about them and what they do. So I love your story. Absolutely fantastic. Let's talk about business in Helena. Helena has a thriving economy, always has. We got through 2008 without the problems that so many other communities had. Median home prices continued to rise through 2008, 10, 12. What are some things that Helena is doing to not only better itself, but attract new businesses like SoFi, to attract them here?
You know, most people nowadays, they don't go into communities because, oh, I'm going to be making $20,000 more, and that should be okay. That's not why they go into those communities. That's not why they go into those cities. They go into the city for the quality of life. And when you talk to people, when you talk to a group like SoFi, you talk to individuals in SoFi, they will tell you the quality of life in Helena is perfect. We have the best trails in the country. Hiking, biking, fishing, hunting. When people hear those things, it's not about the money. It's about the quality of life. And that's, like, I was just talking to a friend last night. He said, "Man, you know, he's doing well, but he had just killed an elk, and he had packaged his elk. And he put it on Facebook, and I said, 'Hey, I don't have elk, but I got fish. Let's barter, you know.'" I mean, look, that's perfect. Hiking, and this guy is an avid biker. He does his mountain bike. He does his hiking. Those are the attractions.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about the money anymore. Because some of us, for where we're at right now in life, no amount of money can bring that happiness. When you can sit back and say, "Oh, geez, I'm going to hike today. Or I'm going to go fish today. Or I'm going to go hunting next week." That's what businesses are looking out for now. The quality of life in those communities. That's why they're coming. And they will continue to come because we're going to continue to improve our quality of life.
There's a really neat thing happening here. I'm going to kind of throw another shout out to Prickly Pear Land Trust here. Prickly Pear Land Trust has a contract with the city, which is a very unique thing for the city to have a contract with a nonprofit. But Prickly Pear helps maintain the trails. They get people invested in the community by getting volunteers to go help maintain trails, build new trails.
Yep.
They do that constantly throughout the season. What an amazing opportunity for businesses, for businesses to really sell Helena. What can we as business owners do better to help sell that? What do you think we're missing when we're trying to sell Helena?
Businesses are not given the full picture. They are more focused on what they are providing to Helena. They are more focused on what they're providing to their employees. It's time for the businesses to step outside of that comfort zone again and let the world know, let the outside world know that it's more than just what we can provide. And then let them start talking about just what you spoke about, our trail system, the beautiful scenery, the lakes, the hunting, the fishing, the hiking, the biking. Those are things that you can't get elsewhere. You just can't get elsewhere. And we have it here right out your back door. As soon as you step out, you're into it.
And amazingly enough, it is literally the trails start a few hundred yards from right here behind the city county building.
Right out your back door. You get out there. You can bike, hike, fish. Fishing is what, 10 minutes away?
Yeah.
I mean, so you have it all right in the city. It's more than just your business, because when you can start telling people about what's in the community besides your business, watch what happens. You will start attracting quality people, because life is not only about working. It's about what do I do after work? What do I do during my vacation? What do I do on my day off?
Absolutely. Uh-huh. You had mentioned when we were just talking offhandedly some things that St. Pete's is doing here.
Oh, yeah. You know, St. Pete's is about to launch a major campaign on life in Helena, because they also want to attract people. So I think next week they're going to be launching a commercial to publicize to the world, to let them know what else we have in Helena. And that's what I encourage businesses to do. Do not only talk about your business, talk about life in Helena. Talk about life around you. That's what makes Helena, Helena. When we can talk about all of Helena, not just the part we consume, not just the part we manage. It's time we talk about our community.
What are some other areas that we as the business community can help out more with, the help the government, help the people of Helena?
You know, don't get me wrong. I know businesses, all businesses, they're there for profits and all of that, but they can just take that one step beyond and educate the outside world about beautiful Helena. And not only Helena, but Montana. Because when you talk about Montana, we have the parks. Let them know we have the parks 2 hours away from us, 3 hours away from us. You can enter one of the most beautiful scenery in the world, 3 hours away from where you live. That's got to count for something.
Absolutely. I always love to tell people, when people say, well, why do you live in Montana? It's cold, it's this, it's that. I tell them the reason I live here is because I get to live in a place where everybody wants to go vacation.
Boom. And not only that, but even when it's cold, do you know that people don't just go up into their cocoons? You're talking about skiing. You're talking about, I mean, there's so much to do. Ice fishing. There's so much to do even when it's cold.
Yeah.
So we don't just hide in cocoon during the winter. We have things to do. There are things to do here also.
So I know you've got a busy calendar. Packed calendar as always. So a couple last things. Are you a reader? Do you love to read books?
You know, I'll be honest with you. Yes. Because I don't do as much anymore, surprisingly, because I used to read myself to sleep. Every night I read. And in fact, my favorite author is John Grisham. I love his books. I have all of his books. I read those books. And so, but with how busy I've been, it's on the back burner, because when I get home, the only thing I want to do is hit my bed, watch the news, and you know, hit the sack. But I would pray that things would slow down in the mayor's office and that I could get back to my normal life and read and do all of that. Like I just showed you, almost 50 pages of thing I got to read, someone sent to me, wanted me to read and get involved with that project. But I do read.
So besides Grisham, anything else that, anything that you think would help businesses in what they're doing, whether it's psychologically or owning and operating a business?
You know, not because, I don't know if you know this other one, that I am also in school.
No.
See, so I am completing my dissertation. I completed my coursework for my PhD in forensic psychology. And so I read a lot of my own school books, mm-hmm. not business books. And so all I can tell is that determination, that drive, that zeal to succeed. If anybody, if businesses, if people who want to do startup have those characteristics, the determination, the zeal, the drive, Helena is the appropriate place to bring that, because we have people that will hold your hand. We have people that will walk with you through the processes that will help you start that business. So this, and that's why I'm passionate when it comes to Helena, because for every avenue you turn, there's someone willing to help you succeed. I'm a witness to that. And I'm sure you're a witness to that also. Someone held your hand and said, this is where you go. Like the I was at that the function last week with the business entities.
Oh, MBAC. Yes.
Look what they did.
Mm-hmm.
They held those businesses' hands, guided them through the processes, and those guys are doing what they need to do now to succeed.
Yes, a fantastic program the other night.
Fantastic. So we have it here in Helena. Just bring that drive, bring that zeal, bring that determination, and leave the rest to us. We will help you succeed.
That is absolutely fantastic. One last question. I'm sure you get this one all the time. Do you have any sort of higher up callings to politically? Why don't we leave that as the final parting question?
I'll tell you this. I'll answer the will of the people. If the people say, Wilmot, we want you here, who am I to say no?
Mayor Collins, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Everybody, thanks for joining us today. I really hope you pulled out as much as I did. Wow, what a great interview with Mayor Collins. Thank you. I'm grinning ear to ear, and I just can't believe what a great treasure this has been for me.
Thank you. I appreciate being here.
So everybody, have a wonderful Thanksgiving. Thanks for joining the Montana Business Vlog. Tune in to us on YouTube. You can go to the Silverman Law Office webpage, mttaxlaw.com, and our videos are up there. And join us, like us there on YouTube, and let's get the word spread that Helena's a great place to do business.
Yes, indeed, it is.